America has been known as the Great Melting Pot, where people from all over the world came to settle for new and better opportunities. As a result, we are a country made up of many diverse people, and it is sometimes easy to forget our own cultural origins. Have you ever wondered about your cultural roots? Have you ever thought about your great-grandparents or your great-great-grandparents and all those in your family who came before you? Do you know their story? Our roots make up our core identity. Our roots put us in connection with our past, our ancestors. They remind us of the struggles of those who came before us. To celebrate their triumphs, to remind us that we come from distant and exotic lands. We are the descendants of strong nations, of proud tribes. And that we are part of a legacy far larger than ourselves. Our heritage influences our language, religious beliefs, foods, and even our clothing. But more importantly, it gives us our principles, our morals, and our values. We are going to hear from several people how discovering and celebrating their roots has helped to make them who they are today.
My father's family directly came from Ireland, so that was a big part of what we talked about growing up. I think Irish-American culture is very interesting because there's Irish culture and there's Irish-American culture, and they kind of merge, so we were very much embroiled in Irish-American culture growing up. My dad specifically did, so St. Patrick's Day was a really big thing in my household. In addition to that, we did celebrate Samhain a little bit, which I'm saying incorrectly, but Halloween is actually an Irish holiday. So I was probably one of the only kids in school who really understood where Halloween came from. I did get to go right before I went to college. I went with my aunt. We got to go all around the coast of Ireland. That was a big deal for me because growing up I had heard stories about Ireland. So it was really awesome to see it. I felt like it was kind of what I expected and kind of not what I expected. But it was a really life-changing experience. As I said, like, Irish culture is very much storytelling culture, so it was really interesting specifically to see like the Cliffs of Moher, which is a very, very big thing in Ireland. It's just a big steep drop and it's beautiful, and something called the Giant's Causeway. The Giant's Causeway in Northern Ireland is a formation of rocks that look like basically steps, so it was interesting to see that my dad was a prolific storyteller, is a nice way of saying funny liar. So it was nice to see that those things actually existed, because Irish storytelling or Blarney is kind of a big deal, so to actually see it in real life was very interesting. So, my father, who is very good at Blarney, which is why I think maybe I'm so good at Blarney, my father maintains that seven brothers snuck away in the middle of the night. Perhaps they may have stolen a horse. I'm not quite sure what the story was, but my understanding is they were not from the upper class. They had gotten in some kerfuffles with the law. They all got in a ship and they all came to America through Canada before there was a wall there either. And they got to America kind of illegally, and they started working on the Erie Canal, and that's how the Mullaneys came to America.
My name is Mrs. Bevan. My family is from Ireland. We always celebrated St. Patrick's Day, and on St. Patrick's Day it was traditional to wear green and shamrock things, and we also made corned beef and cabbage, which is a traditional Irish food. I've been to Ireland twice. I went once with my family, my parents and my brother, and I went once with my husband. When I went with my family, it was important to all of us to go there and to travel around and see the types of homes that they lived in and what the land is like and the cities, and experience what our ancestors would have experienced more than 100 years ago. We have always celebrated who we are and where we come from, and I think it's important for everybody to do that to the extent that they're capable and to share that tradition. I know I do that with my children, who get excited about St. Patrick's Day too, and who are interested in Ireland, and I would love to take them there someday.
Hi, my name is Ms. Richardson McCray, and I teach ENL ELA. My father's family, actually his father is from Jamaica, and his mother is from Curacao. My family met and, well, their parents met and got married in St. Martin. My mother's side of the family is from New Orleans, Louisiana. So all of us participated in carnival when we're Juve, which is what it's called in St. Martin. We all celebrate that. We all come together as a family. We have Sunday dinner, get together for all of the different activities on the island. When I was younger, nobody wanted to be something an American. Everybody just wanted to be American. So you would lose your accent, you would lose, you know, that vernacular, that lexicon. You wouldn't use those terminologies from the island. You would only speak in English, the King's English or regular English from America. But it became very interesting as I was in college and learned a lot more about being a Black woman and what that means, and then connecting with my family and appreciating the food and the culture and the music and everything that goes into being West Indian American. I feel the closest to my heritage and to my family. It just feels like home.
I'm Mr. Jeffrey, and I teach French here at Belport Middle School. And so my ancestral background is Caribbean on both sides of my family. My mother was born on the island of Jamaica. My dad, even though he was born here, his parents, they were born on the island of Barbuda. Barbuda is a satellite island associated with the other island of Antigua. About 5 years ago, I had a chance to go to the island of Jamaica. I had only ever been to Jamaica when I was 2 years old, and it was on the occasion of my grandfather's funeral. And I had never gone back until an uncle of mine about 5 years ago passed away, and I was able to go back to Jamaica for really the first time in my adult life. And I was overwhelmed by the beauty of the island, but also overwhelmed by the people. And being around Jamaicans, I suddenly recognized in myself many of the ethics and morals and just the culture that I grew up. I all of a sudden came to an understanding of exactly why my mom was the way she was and the way she looked at life just by being on the island. And so it was a wonderful experience for me, and I was so happy to have gone. Well, technically, the island of Barbuda and the island of Jamaica, their languages are technically English, their number one language. But of course, if you've ever been around Jamaicans or anybody from the Caribbean, they speak English, but they also speak Patois, which is kind of a broken English. And yeah, man, me can't speak some Jamaican Patois if you want me to. Both sides of my family were very, very proud of their Caribbean heritage. And so from food to music to being Caribbean has really shaped the way I am. Caribbeans are very open-minded, but at the same time, they're also very, very conservative when it comes to family values. Families are very important. Respect for your parents and for older ones, it's very important. I grew up with a deep sense of appreciation and respect for my family. And also, that's kind of influenced the way I was when I was growing up. I never, for example, thought of, you know, for a moment of speaking back to my mom. That's just not something that Caribbeans would ever do to their parents. But also a closeness. My cousins and I were more than just cousins. We were brothers and sisters. Our extended family was just as close and as tight as our my immediate family, my mother and father and my brothers and sister. I was as close to my cousins and my aunts and uncles as to anybody, and I would never exchange that for anything. Among the values that I grew up with was the strong idea of importance of education. My grandfather, my mother's father, was an educator, and one of my aunts was a college professor. In fact, it's so funny that my mother tells the story of when she was growing up, she never called her father dad. She and her siblings always referred to him, and they called him lovingly teacher. And that's what they called him. And he was a principal, or as they would say, a headmaster of a boys' school. And then he later became a superintendent of schools on the island of Jamaica. And so I grew up with understanding the importance of education. And that's why I'm a teacher today. It's kind of like a family tradition.
Hi, I'm Ms. Vecchione. I am the bilingual social worker here at the middle school. I am from Puerto Rico. Both of my parents came here from Puerto Rico. They didn't know any English or anything like that, so they were really learning the American culture, but at the same time teaching me what the Puerto Rican culture was about. And so, you know, whether it was through food and through the language, they really integrated it in our everyday lives. Definitely traditional Puerto Rican cuisine is the mofongo, which is like a plantain bowl and then has like chicharrón mixed into it, and you can have it with any type of meat and broth. But one of the best things was probably during Christmas time, our family would participate in what's called like a parranda, which you go to visit different families' houses or, you know, your friends' houses. It's supposed to be kind of like a surprise, but you come with like a lot of instruments and food, and it's kind of like a surprise, like pop-up party that you would throw at other people's houses. And it was really like very lively and a lot of fun. As growing up, we went every 2 years. And then as an adult, I've gone a few times too with my own family. I love going to Puerto Rico. My grandparents live in the countryside, and most of my family still lives there. So my parents are both, they're one out of six each, the siblings. So most of my family still lives in Puerto Rico, but just growing up with both of my grandparents, they basically like live off the land. So, you know, picking mangoes and going in the backyard, getting avocados, climbing the coconut trees, kind of like that. So I really love that part of it. Being able to know the Spanish language and being able to speak to other people in Spanish and help them if they don't know English, it's helped me definitely with my career and different jobs I've had. One of the things my parents always showed us was, you know, like being generous and being humble. And I definitely witnessed that a lot through my grandparents too, and seeing how they lived and grew up. You know, the houses in Puerto Rico, especially where they live in the countryside, are not like mansions or anything like that, but they're beautiful in their own way. But like, you know, even learning to live off the land and, you know, growing the crops and, you know, just things like that, I feel like kind of humble you and then allow you to be generous when you have. Some of the other things is like, vamos a hanguear, that's like, let's hang out. That's like a slang kind of word. So it's kind of funny listening to Puerto Ricans talk because we have our own kind of slang and language. I know that they've always pushed their children to, you know, better themselves, and all of my parents and siblings are, you know, very professional, whether they stayed in Puerto Rico or have moved to other states. But definitely, you know, my grandpa is always very into education and bettering yourself and making a career. So he's always like, every time he speaks to me, he talks about like, you know, how did you do in college? How's school going? How's this? And, you know, he always wants me to further my education.
Rosemont. I teach math, 7th and 8th grade. My father is Chinese. My mom is Chinese and Thai, but mainly we speak Thai because that's my mother's side. We came here when I was 6 due to a war. We were a refugee, and a church took sponsored us. We moved here from North Carolina, and then we stayed there for about 3 months, and a church in Smithtown sponsored us. So we took the train, hiked over, and we lived in Smithtown for about, I guess until I was in 4th grade. So it was very hard to keep our traditions because there was no one of my kind around for a while. And then we started finding people that were from Laos. So also, I'm Laos, Laotian. So my family speaks Thai, Laotian, English, and Chinese. We mainly speak a dialect of Thai close to border to Laos. That's why I say Laotian. And the reason why we were here is because Laos was taken over by a communist country, Vietnam, and that was like the end of the Vietnam War. So we had to flee our country. And my father couldn't stay in Thailand because he's Chinese, so we stayed in a refugee camp for about 6 months. I remember when I was younger, there is a Thai temple actually that was built in, I believe it's in Middle Country. It's huge now, but when we first started, it was just at someone's house. It would be the Thai New Year, and basically the Thai New Year is about sprinkling water. So when you see someone, it's just an all-day festival with being wet and food. So when I was younger, we couldn't actually throw water at people, but all of the Thai and Laotian people would get together on the New Year. They would rent out a hall. And the one thing I didn't like was the girls had to dance. And I didn't like dancing because the Thai dancing, you had to wear this whole ensemble and you had to do something with your hands. So if you look at my hands, like you had to bend it all the way back and you had to wear these like nails and tips. So we'd have to do something like this, and I'm not a dancer at all, so I didn't like that. So we did that for about 4 years, and then we moved here from Smithtown. So when I came to Belport, it was a huge shock because I was the only Asian girl in Belport. I started at Frank B. Long, went to the middle school and the high school. So kind of around like 4th grade, that's when we stopped with the doing the traditions. When I was younger, I hated being Asian. I didn't like looking in the mirror because I was different. I didn't know anything because I came here when I was 6 years old, and it was just my family, the 7 of us, 5 kids, my mom and my dad. And wherever I went, when I was younger, all the way up going up, I guess when I was in my 20s, I've always wanted to be a blonde. I wanted to be tall. I didn't like my eyes. I didn't like my skin color. I just didn't really appreciate being Asian until I got a little bit older and just visiting where I came from. And I am so happy and lucky that I am. I have two worlds. I'm Asian, I'm an Asian American. And I think that makes me who I am. Last year, I'm 44 now, so I came when I was 6. So I've been dying to go back just to see how things work. So we decided last summer to go to visit Thailand. My parents go every summer. They go for the month of July, and they stay there until like mid-August. So this year I went with my family, my husband and my two boys. The city of Bangkok is, I mean, just like New York City. Huge, tons of people. A lot of traffic. We stayed in there for a little bit, and then we traveled to Chiang Mai, the northern part. I wanted to see everything, so we traveled to the north, the south, east, west, and then we stayed at my mom's village. It was a eye-opener. We went to visit the schools. There were 385 students, kindergarten to 8th grade. I wanted to show that to my son too, who's in 4th grade, just how lucky, how fortunate we are. The school there, they stop at 8th grade. So if you don't pass a certain test, then you're not allowed to go to the high school. So if you're not good, you don't pass, then you are done. You are basically a rice farmer or doing other things. And that's the reason why I'm really fortunate. I'm very glad that I am here in the United States because I think it's the best country ever.
Hello, my name is Mrs. Benikos, and I teach Italian at Bellport Middle School. I'm first generation Italian, so we spent a lot of time doing the cultural aspects of the food. But when my parents came from Italy, they wanted to become American citizens. So I grew up speaking English and learned Italian to spite them. I do food for all the different holidays, and in addition to that, I try to learn how it was originally made. So I do my own wine, I do my own liqueurs, I do my own jam, I do my own tomato sauce from fresh tomatoes, and pickling things like they did, you know, centuries ago. Well, as you know, most of Italy is Roman Catholic, so I do the traditional Catholic holidays with the family. Basically, when I travel there, I try to experience what they do with the little festivals. They have festivals for different months. So I used to go at least once a year when I was younger. My dad worked for an airline, so, and my, like I said, I'm first generation, so my whole family's from there. So we used to go two or three times a year, and then as I got older, once every probably 4 or 5 years. I am still overwhelmed by the beauty of Italy. Every region speaks to me in a different way. My mom's from the south, my dad's from the north, and I honestly can't get enough of it. When I retire, I think I'm going to rent like a little villa and in summer there. I think it's super important for all of us to connect with our culture. I think some people just say, oh, I speak English and that's it. When you go to Europe, not just Italy, they speak 3 and 4 languages. So I remember going as a kid and seeing other kids my age speak to me in English to try to communicate with me, which is what another reason I wanted to learn Italian, to communicate back. In Europe, they all speak many languages. In addition, just the desire to learn different cultures. How they spend the Italian day is much different than our day. You know, it's more about living to live instead of living to work. Going out to eat is a whole experience. Going to the beach is a whole experience. It's like a way of life.
My name is Mr. DePoma, and my ancestral origin is Italy. So we did celebrate in many different ways. We would keep some of the traditions alive that got passed down from my grandparents and my great-grandparents. Things like dinners, big family dinners on Sundays, making sure that we had the 7 fish when it was time for Christmas and having all of the family over for Christmas Eve. I went to Italy a couple years ago with my family, and we visited many different places around Italy, a lot of our capital cities like Rome, Florence, Venice. It was pretty incredible. It was really awesome to go there and to experience all of these places that I had heard about and read about. And it was really awesome to be back in the country of my ancestors and to feel that connection, and especially having studied Italian in college, to see these places up close and personal, like the Colosseum and the Duomo. And it's not just a place in a textbook, but to be there and to actually see places in person and to get the feel, a sense of that history and what it's meant throughout the centuries. So knowing my ancestral origin has allowed me to feel that connection between who I am today and the past, and kind of knowing the struggle of where my ancestors came from, their journey from Italy and the old world to make a better life for themselves in America. They came here in the 1800s and they sailed across on a boat. And I mean, it wasn't an airplane, it was rocky seas, lots of waves. They didn't know what was coming for them. They didn't have a job waiting for them, but they just had this courage and this hope and this like faith that things were gonna work out in this new country. And my great-grandfather came here with $16 in his pocket, and that was it. And so he had no choice except to like make it. And I think that knowing those stories about who they were and coming here, it kind of empowered me to be like, you know, we have to take risks, we have to take chances. Yeah, knowing their story has really kind of given me inspiration to, you know, seek out my dreams and to pursue the things that I wanted to do in my life.
I think I would say hard work. My parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, they're all hard workers. He became a coal miner. He would be in the mines day in and day out, working back-breaking jobs to provide for his family. My grandfather worked two jobs to support his family. So the value of hard work is something that runs deep in my family. The importance of family and the importance of celebrating where we've come from and how far we've come, and to kind of recognize, take time to recognize who we are as a people.
Hola, bom dia. Eu sou a Senhora Pereira e hoje eu vou falar contigo sobre Portugal. I am Portuguese. Yes, we celebrated many things in my family. One thing in particular is the food. We cook many things. I remember growing up, my dad would make sausage. He would make wine, he would make bread, all from scratch. We would spend Sundays making bread that's full of meat, and it's called foulard. And it's a recipe that was passed down from my great-grandmother to my grandmother to my mother, and now I have the recipe. And so for Easter or for Christmas, we always make this bread. Growing up, speaking Portuguese was something very important for my family. My brother speaks Portuguese and I speak Portuguese, and it's because we went to Portuguese school. It's in Farmingville, it's a little school, and you would go for 3 hours a day, once a week, and they would teach you how to read, how to speak, understand, and write in Portuguese. And so that's really important for me. So one day when I have children, I'm gonna send them to that same school so they can learn how to speak in Portuguese as well. I went to Portugal many, many times. We used to go once every year. My parents would drop me off in Portugal and I would stay there for 2 months during the summertime, and I was able to see my entire father's side of the family. My grandma and grandpa are there from my dad's side, my cousins, aunts, uncles. I loved going there. It's so different from Long Island. Just a bunch of farms. There was like little pigs and chickens running everywhere, and my job every morning was to wake up and feed the animals. I would help my grandma cut corn, peel beans, things like that. It's just a simple life. It was really great. I feel like I learned a lot from spending time there with my family. My grandparents would always talk about how I have an easy life in America. I don't have to wake up and work on the farm. I go to school here. I don't, you know, things are just different in Portugal. So my grandparents would always talk about how privileged I am to be here and to have this life. My grandparents didn't have much when they were young, and when they had my parents, they were poor in Portugal as well, and they left Portugal to come here to New York, to America, for a better life. So all my life I've been watching my parents work really hard, three jobs, you know, working every day, saving every penny, doing everything for us. So something that I learned from watching them is just working hard, saving, being a good person, and respecting each other. My parents came here in 1978. They came here to have a better life. If my parents had stayed there, they would have become farmers. They would have been farmers for the rest of their lives. And my mom and dad didn't want that for their future children. So when they had the opportunity, they came here.
I feel every culture and every immigrant to America has gone through some sort of hardship. So if you look back at how the first wave of immigration happened with Ireland, the Irish were not well respected. The Irish were considered the outsider, and there was a lot of discrimination. So regardless of where you came from, coming to a new country is very, very hard. And understanding that your ancestors went through something that's very hard helps you be more empathetic for others.
Where we come from shapes who we are, because we understand the struggles of our ancestors who came for me a very long time ago, but who struggled to be accepted here in the United States. And I think learning more about their struggles helps me to understand the challenges that new immigrants face today.
I found that knowing where my family came from and their history has grounded me in a greater understanding of who I need to be as a person. It's true that people who went to the Caribbean, especially darker-skinned people of African descent, were brought to the Caribbean as slaves. That history had kind of informed what my family chose to do and what they became, and as a result, what I've become. I know that when slavery ended in the islands, many folks, they struggled, but they fought to become something much more than just ex-slaves, which is why my grandfather and some other members of my family pursued really noble professions such as teaching and medicine and nursing, and that's what they became. They very much had a belief that despite our past, we could become something better and impact the world. And it's so those beliefs that have informed me as I grew up, that no matter what the past may have been and what my heritage may have been or what my ancestors may have faced negatively in the past, they could move on and build greater lives and greater selves for themselves. And that's what I strive to do.
I think it makes us all so unique to know where we came from and to just be able to hold on to certain things that we love about our ancestry and our own culture. But definitely, I think one of the best things about like Hispanic culture is being bold and empowered and knowing that you can have a bright future if you, you know, work hard and put in your effort.
It just taught me just to work really hard and believe in people. Because when I came here, we had so much help, my teachers, the community, and I think that's so important, you know, to know where your parents, the sacrifices that they made, and why are they here, but not saying forget who you are, because I think both worlds is great.
I just think it makes you more of a well-rounded person, not just your own ancestral roots, but to learn different cultures and get to know different people. I mean, the more you learn, the smaller the world becomes.
It's who you are. It's what you are. It's so important to know your background, where your parents come from.
You really have to know where you come from to know where you're going. It's like, when you don't know your roots, you don't know where you come from, you're almost like a tossed and driven in the wind. You just don't have any foundation.
So knowing your ancestral roots is important because if you don't know where you've come from, you won't be able to know where you're going. So by finding your roots and knowing where your family came from, it gives you a greater sense of appreciation for the things that you have now. So knowing that, I have a greater appreciation and a sense of appreciation for all of the opportunities that have been afforded to me and my family in this country.